I put on this lava lamp in the background, but it's not completely warmed up yet, so it looks really weird. But I hope that during this video, it'll go and it'll end up looking really cute and vibey. Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. Today we're gonna talk about the worst books of 2020, aka all the books that didn't really do it for me. They didn't really butter my egg roll. They weren't really the cherry on top of my cake. You know, first, a disclaimer. This is just my personal opinion.
I'm not saying that these
we
books
all
are
have different
opinions. It's just totally okay.
Please don't sacrifice me to the gods. This is just my opinion. Okay. So I didn't give a single book one star this year. So all the books on this list definitely had some redeeming qualities, but I still just want to have a fun talk about all the things that frustrated me and that I have some critiques on. In the past years, I've done a ranking, but this year I noticed I don't really know how to rank them. And there are kind of three categories that the books on my list fall into. So I just divided them into the three subcategories, which are I don't get it, great idea, bad execution, and the third category is disappointing YA fantasy, which is ironic, I am aware. I just noticed that half of the books on this list turned out to be YA fantasy. But don't worry, because on my best books of 2020 list that'll be coming soon, there's also a lot of YA fantasy, so don't worry. Alright, let's begin with the first category, which is I don't get it, aka it's just, this was just not really my thing. Let's just immediately start off with a very popular one, and that is The Kiss Quotient by Helen Huang. This year I really tried to get into adult romances, and I picked up this one. It's about this woman who basically hires an escort to teach her how to do all the romantic and the sexy things. This is an adult romance where the characters just kind of constantly have sex. And it just wasn't my thing. I thought there was too much going on. I prefer my romance books to have a little bit more build-up. I ended up caring for the characters way more than the romance between them. And I found the writing style to be very distant. It didn't really do it for me. I understand why a lot of people would like it, but this is just not the type of romance that I enjoy reading. And then we have a very sad one, and that is the Winter Night series. So let me tell you the story about this. It's a fairy tale-esque historical fantasy that takes place in Russia about a girl who can see folklore creatures. Sounds fantastic and exactly up my alley, but I just didn't understand why I didn't like it. I was wrecking my brain trying to figure out why this book didn't click for me and why I quite frankly wanted to fall asleep every time I picked up this book. I thought there was something wrong with me because I'm supposed to love these kind of fairy tale-esque stories. And after a few days of soul searching after DNFing the second book in the series, I finally found out why this book didn't do it for me. Because this story is very much written like a fairy tale is written, and that is that you kind of just focus on the broad story and the characters just kind of fulfill their duties within the story, but you don't really get to see from their perspective, you don't really get to see inside their minds. They're just doing the stuff that they gotta do. The story is very distant from the characters. It's more about the tale as a fairy tale would, and that just didn't work for me. So that's why I think this series just wasn't my thing. Then we have a very popular classic, and that is The Lord of the Flies by William Golding, the classic story about a bunch of boys that get shipwrecked on an island and just anarchy breaks loose in like the worst way possible. Sometimes you read a classic and you think to yourself, did I miss something? Like, did I miss the memo? Why are people raving about this book? I just don't see it. And that's what I had with Lord of the Flies. All I could think while reading this book was this would never happen. I think my frustration with this book comes more with the way people talk about this book rather than the book itself, because people often use this book as an argument. Oh, don't you remember what happened in Lord of the Flies? Think about what happened in Lord of the Flies. And I'm like, it's fiction. It's a work of fiction. Someone made this up. Please don't use this as an argument. Just a personal gripe of me. When I talked about this book in my wrap-up, someone did point out that it was also supposed to be kind of a critique on war and how childish war is, and I do like that interpretation of the book, but overall, not a big fan of this one. Moving on to the next category, we have great idea, but bad execution. So books that just didn't really fulfill their potential to me. The first one is the Truly Devious series, especially the second and the third book. I think binge reading the Truly Devious series was like one of the highlights of my 2020, even though I ended up being quite frustrated with it, it was still a wild and fun ride. This is a really fun YA mystery series about this boarding school where people with like really great talents come to, and our main character has this big talent for detective work, and there's a murder. Very fun setup for a story. But oh boy, was I disappointed with this one. So I like the setting and the vibe and the representation that happens in this book. But other than that, the characters are really fun in the first book until you realize towards the second and the third book that they never develop past their stereotypes. The mystery is dragged out over three books so that it can be a trilogy, even though this very clearly could have all just been one book. And it's one of those mystery books where the plot twists are extremely frustrating because you don't see them coming because they're not foreshadowed. And the revelations themselves I found to be very underwhelming in a way that it is set up to be something really, really interesting, but then it turns out to be this completely different thing that you couldn't have seen coming that is actually not as interesting at all. It's hard to talk about it without spoiling. But yeah, there's gonna be a fourth book in this series coming out in half of 2021. And will I be reading it? Yes, you bet I will. You betcha I will be reading more of this series. Then we have The Library of the Unwritten. This is a fantasy book with a very unique idea behind a very unique premise. It takes place in a library of hell that is full of the books that were never finished. I just couldn't get through it because this one suffered kind of from the same problem as the Winter Night trilogy, is that I never got to care about the character. There's constant action, it's a super original story, but I just really lacked the motive of the characters, and I really just wished that there was some more time to set up the world and kind of get used to the world and get used to all the characters before immediately jumping into all the action. Like most of the books on this list, a lot of people did really like this book, and I totally understand why. It just wasn't for me. Is this going anywhere? Not really, huh? It's still not moving. And then we get to the last category with four books in them, and that is the disappointing YA fantasy category. Very, very sad. Let's just get into it. First one I actually have a physical copy of, and that is The Shadows Between Us by Tricia Levenseller. You may know that I was extremely excited for this book. I even pre-ordered it, which I rarely do, because this was supposed to be my perfect book, okay? I'm still bitter about this. It's a fantasy story about this girl who is going to marry like the evil ruler of the country, and her plan is to woo him and then kill him, which sounds like the setup of a great story with enemies to lovers romance and morally gray character. But instead, what I got was a story that really tried to be an enemies to lovers romance with morally gray characters, but didn't really get any further than constantly telling you that that's what it is. The narration will constantly tell you how bad and murderous the main character is, but she doesn't actually do anything except for like that one time that she did kill someone, but we rarely go into that. And we're also constantly told that the love interest, the villain, is very evil and dark and evil, but he also doesn't really do much that is morally ambiguous. And in like the rare instance that the characters do something morally gray, it's in this really weird way where it's like presented as like, whoa, so cool, they just murdered someone, ha, lol, so cool, they're so bad. Instead of, you know, being actually talking about the moral grayness and moral ambiguity of the situation. I have a whole review in which I go into why I think the anti-hero characters failed and why I think the romance failed, so if you want to see me rant about this book in hopefully an entertaining way, I will link it up the screen up there. Really, just so sad. Like, I rarely buy hardcovers, and then when I do, I end up not liking the book. Shame. Oh, it has completely collapsed. Oh, I think it's gonna start doing the thing. We're gonna see blobs very soon, my friends. Meanwhile, we're gonna continue to the next disappointing YA book, and that was Star Daughter. This one's in the category of really could have been a lot better and didn't quite reach its potential. We follow the really original story of a girl who is half star. When her father is injured, the main character is taken up to the Star Kingdom, where she has to compete in this competition, and if she wins, she can save her father. Very cool concept, right? It just never really like fully reached its potential, in my opinion. Oh my god, we have blobs, my guys. We have blobs. Anyway, most of Star Daughter is just people talking to the main character and explaining the world to the main character. I think we're constantly told how beautiful and exceptional everything is, but I think it kind of lacked description. Like in my wrap-up, I gave the example of there's this one scene where she kind of dances through the sky and like sees the stars around her, and it's described how she sees everything about her ancestors, etc. But it's never described, and I'm like, tell it to me, like describe what she's seeing, describe the things that she's seeing instead of telling me that she's seeing things. There's also a setup for a really great father-daughter relationship that is also just not, it's just kept shallow, it's not deepened the way it could have been. So all in all, was kind of disappointed by this one. Then the next book we have is Kingdom of the Wicked by Kerry Maniscalco. Oh boy, was this book a wild ride. Just like the Truly Devious series, this is a book that I thoroughly enjoyed, but also frustrated the hell out of me. So this is a fantasy story that takes place in Sicily, in Italy, and it's about a girl who is a witch. When her twin sister is murdered brutally, she finds the help of this demon, summons this demon from hell, who is then going to help her find the murderer of their sisters, and there are like these seven princes of hell that all represent one of the deadly sins. Very cool concept again, but let's just talk about it. First of all, we never actually know when this book takes place. We know that it's in Sicily, and it seems to be some kind of historical setting, but we never get a year, and judging by the way the clothes are described, it's more like an idea of what historical Italy looked like and not what it actually was. I only know that it takes place in Italy because we are told that it takes place in Italy, and we often get descriptions of nice food, but that's it. No other cultural influences. We have our main character whose twin sister is like brutally murdered, and she finds her body, and we barely get any grief from her. We have our demon boy love interest, which I will admit is a fantastic concept for a romance, and I did enjoy that part of the story, but we are constantly told, not shown, that he is extremely bad and evil and the main character's enemy. The author really wants you to know that the main character and the love interest are enemies, and that this is an enemies to lovers romance, and therefore she will constantly tell you how much of enemies they are instead of showing it, because throughout the entire book, these two people work together. They have absolutely no antagonistic dynamic between them. And it's another one of those mysteries where the plot twists are either predictable or you're surprised by them because they weren't foreshadowed in any way. So, very nice. Again, I totally understand why people enjoyed this book, because I cannot emphasize enough that this book is extremely addictive. It just, also a lot of things that frustrated me. And then the last book that disappointed me this year is A Deadly Education by Naomi Novak, which is really sad because I really liked her other books, Uprooted and Spinning Silver, but this one just very clearly wasn't for me. I don't think it's a bad book, but it just really wasn't for me. This is a very setting-based story. It takes place in this dark academia vibe magic school where there are no teachers and no classes. You just have to teach yourself, because if you don't learn how to do magic, you're gonna get eaten by the thousands of monsters that roam this secret magic school. And the story is very much based on this setting. We get a lot of exposition, a lot of info dumping about this world, which I can understand is gonna be very cool to some people, but to me, it just didn't really do anything, because we didn't really have any very interesting characters to carry the story. Most of the story is basically just the characters fighting the monsters in this school, and it just wasn't enough to keep me interested. unfortunately. So I won't be continuing this series. Oh my god, I'm losing my voice. And those were all the books that I wanted to vent about in this video. If you don't yet follow me on Twitter and Instagram, you should follow me for very mediocre content. You don't want to miss out on that. It's at TheBookLeo. I really hope you enjoyed this video. Please share with me what your worst book of the year was. And I will see with you. I will see with you. What? I will see you in another video. Goodbye.